Welcome everyone to this session, Best Practices as for Android Development as a Daily Business. Sorry, I'm just amazed how many people are trying to fit in this room. Today I learned best practices are very popular. So lessons learned for me, thank you for that. Also another revelation before I really start. I feel the title is a little fuzzy because daily business is not that what I meant, to be honest, because you all work in Android on a daily basis. What I meant, what I really meant with daily business is multi-project management. So what I'm trying to talk about today are best practices for teams who work on multiple projects at a time. Before I really dive into this session, I'd like to introduce AppCom as introduce AppCom and myself as well. We at AppCom consider ourselves as your partner for digital adventures. So if you have an idea, a prototype, or working software, doesn't matter, we take care of the issues. So we help you. We help you to plan every aspect of your how you realize your project. So if it's release management, portfolio strategy, design, UX concept, and of course software architecture and implementation as well. We do a lot of apps, so hence the name AppCom, but we also do portal and backend solutions as well. Myself, I'm a software developer for over 15 years right now. I started very early on by developing games. Unfortunately, nothing fancy too far, and I started developing Android applications for 3 years now, and I'm working as software architect for the last 2 years. Oh, sorry. All right, another disclaimer before we really dive into the session. I'm not here to sell you anything, and I'm also not here to let me celebrate or brag or something like that. We learned in the last 3 years a lot from the from the Android community, and we feel like we want to give you something back. So that's why we're here. We want to share our knowledge we found over the last 3 years. So why should you care? Why should you care about another guy saving or presenting his best practices? There are a lot of best practices out in the internet. You can learn from that. So why does it matter that I show you ours? Why not? You are here to learn something anyway, yeah? Right? We want to share all of it. So why not? Keep an open mind, and maybe you can take something out of it for you too. And also, what I try to focus on is our best practice for small teams having a huge workload. So I try to emphasize on the journey we made over the last 3 years, and I want to show you how you can handle huge workload in smaller teams. Then again, we have huge experience with very well-known clients, especially in Germany and Europe. And also, we tackled some of more advanced techniques, like releasing in custom stores, like the Citrix Zen mobile store, which was quite difficult, to be honest, and also like MDNS, NFC, and stuff like that. So every journey has its start, so let's look at the very beginning of our journey. How did we start 3 years ago? We started out with a very stable but small department. We had three developers at max, now we have four. And we started with a huge knowledge base about clean code, important libraries like Dagger, X-Java, and stuff like that. And of course, some of the architectural patterns like MVP, MVVM. On the other hand, we had many concurrent projects at a time. Each had its tight and very important, of course, deadlines and its perks, which made it very tricky to work with. Like, as I already said, the Sun Mobile Store and various others. So, what were the really big pain points? Of course, many concurrent projects. Nobody likes that. Tight deadlines. That's another very bad thing. And also a small department. Basically, we were very few developers who had many projects with a tight schedule. So what did we do? Disclaimer, I hope this is no surprise. We didn't practice any witchcraft, stopping time or something like that. We just followed some very basic and simple rules we found to optimize the process and the workflow in our department. And I try to emphasize why it matters and why you should do it too if you already don't. Also, let's get into it. We wanted to write less code because writing less code is always more time for us, and time is key, especially when working with many projects at a time. So what we did is we analyzed where we can use annotations and where we can substitute code with annotations. I think you all know this piece of code, not this one especially, but you all wrote an activity or fragment or stuff like that and set the content view for a view. What we did is we created an annotation, a so-called layout annotation, and we created an abstract activity or fragment or whatever you want and just loaded the layout from there. So what we did basically is we got rid of the inflation boilerplate code, which is always a good thing because the resulting code will look like this. Two benefits. The first one is the activity or fragment looks very clean, and it's also very descriptive because I don't want to write any code to get my layout inflated. I just want to be descriptive, to be as descriptive as possible. Also, it's faster to write. Again, we saved some time. And also, it's easier to read. And reading code very easily is especially important when working in teams, because chances are that developer who wrote that code is not the developer. The developer is reading that code, is not the developer who wrote the code. So it's very easy to make the code as readable as possible, so make it easier for your colleague. All right, the next thing to do, you did this all, is using libraries. Well-suited libraries, of course. It's very noble to write all the code by yourself, I know, but on a tight schedule, nobility is not an option. Especially the top lane is a very time saver. I know some of them are criticized, also for good reason, but keep in mind that this scenario I'm talking about, or the context I'm talking about, is very few people, many projects at a time, very few time, and in that manner, libraries or using libraries is a real time saver. All right, one thing that happens when you work in a team is that everyone has its unique coding style. Having your unique coding style is perfectly fine. Yeah, that's very natural. But when working in a team, it's a good thing that you speak in the same language in terms of coding style, so it's easier to read. Consider these two functions. They were written by two distinct developers. And when you think about it, that your whole code base looks like this, it's a mess. Because every time you go in a class or read a function, you have to just pass the coding style. So applying a unique code style for your whole team will uniform the code base and will look like this, which is easier to read for all of us. Again, I don't want to force you to use our code style, but I want to show you that applying code style is very important. If you wonder, we use the Android Square coding style, which can be downloaded here. Okay, code styles are just a subset of the so-called coding guidelines. When you're defining code guidelines, you just you define more than the style, but you also define how to name variables, what package structure you're using, what architecture you're using, and stuff like that. So when you skip coding guidelines, every developer will choose its own style he is using so far, and the code base will look like a mess, especially when you skip the architectural part. So what we did is just, like I said, we defined all of it, So that we have a code base which is healthy and easier to maintain. And also what we did unintentionally was applying the convention over configuration pattern, which will force you that the code base of each project will look alike. So when you switch projects, you always feel that you've seen this before, because the last project just looked like this. We also published our coding guidelines. You can find them here. The main benefit when you define how variable names are, how to name variables, you can derive life templates from it. You all know life templates, I hope, at least. And I hope also that you know that life templates can be parameterized. So I consider this piece of code over here. We have three variables, the view ID, the type, and the view ID camel case. And the view ID camel case is based on the view ID. So when I enter the view ID camel case is written out without me doing anything. So that when you put this into practical things, you see that when I name a variable user preview image view, the name of the variable is also automatically set. And also, we clock this line. You can write that in less than a second. And when you consider a very complex layout, you see that you can save a huge amount of time. These are just some examples of our live templates. You don't have to read at all. You can find them also here. We publish them. And also another tip, when you want to share live templates, make it as easy as possible. We've seen the Square Android repository earlier. I showed at least a link to it. And we this repository is based on it. So you can install the live templates as easy as the code style. So the next thing is also pretty obvious, apply an architecture, of course. You all need an architecture in your Android app. And if you document and communicate it to the team, they can all apply it in each project, convention over configuration. I just want to go over our architectural style. Again, I don't want to force you to use it. I just wanted to emphasize that having an architecture is very important. So usually we have an application activity and a fragment scope. In each scope, there is the Android lifecycle aware object, an application or activity or fragment. We have also the classes which are relevant for the dependency injection, and also some sort of controllers which provide in common functionality, like starting intents for phone, email, or stuff like that, loading assets and files. Same goes for the activity scope, and in our fragment scope, we use the MVP pattern and interactors. This is just the app module. We also have usually a second module, which is the data module. The main interface of the data module are so-called data stores. In these data stores, we provide an interface for manipulating so-called data objects, which are models and entities. I will get to that. Each data store utilizes some sort of data source, which can be a web data source, assets, memcache, a web service, database, stuff like that. And also, this works very well when using X-Java. But this is out of scope. Then we have data source agnostic entities. They are models which are provided by the data stores, and also their respective transformers. All right, one more very useful tip we found over the years is the toString method. Consider a POJO, a very complex one, if you will. When you log into the logcat without overwriting toString, you get this. That's pretty useful. But I'd like to see something more, so I overwrite toString method and I will get this. So this is very readable for now. But if I put many more objects into this, so a nested object or a very complex object, it gets harder to read because, many of the attributes and also the line breaks by the logcat. So what we basically did is we overwrote the toString method in Android Studio, and we will get JSON. That's pretty useful because when we take this JSON and format it, we get this. And this is especially works when you have complex objects and nested objects because it's still human readable, just a bit lengthy. All right, I will conclude this session because I don't have any more time. When I read that sign correctly, the main thing you should focus when working in a small team with a huge workload is write less code, have more time, because time is key. You need time to also focus on things that matter. Convention over configuration is very helpful because you will skip projects or you will do project hopping, and when you know one project and you find yourself better in the second project, that's very helpful because you save time by that. Automize everything, including live templates, and have an architecture set. So to conclude this session, I have two more slides. I hope I get them in time. Have fun. Learn, help, share. You work on the same team. You work for the same projects and success. So yeah, work as a team. Also, some marketing I had to include it. We provide a workshop for you guys. So if you want to learn more about Android and how to launch products and with validated methods like Lean Startup, follow the link, join us, and get a free registration for the workshop. You can also find us on Facebook, Twitter, and GitHub, of course. And I'd like to see you soon. Reach out to us. And yeah, let's make the world better. Thank you.